Hello, everybody. Welcome into the Apples and Genos Fantasy Hockey Podcast. My name is Nate Gertnipolink. I'm the creator of Apples and Genos, originator of the Zero G Draft Strategy. And in this podcast, Blake and I are going to give you all the best streamers and ad options for next week so you can start planning early. Let's get it. Of course, I have your friend and my best friend here to steam us up. It's Blake Creamer. Blake, how are you feeling tonight?
Very, very steamy, dreamy, and creamy.
The best combination.
Yeah, that's how I operate. Buddy, we got hockey happening here. Oh, man. I know I did the waiver show last week, but this feels like the true first waiver show that we're doing. And this is something that I just love doing with you. This is one of my favorite shows we do, and we're getting into our regular content here. Oh, man, we're going to have an awesome season. And yeah, things have got off to a good start for both of us, it sounds like, in our matchups.
Yep. Yeah, I don't want to write the awards too soon, but has been a good start across the board. So hoping we cross fingers, carry on throughout the season. I feel like the last few years I've had like some pretty unexciting starts across my leagues. And yep. I've like gone through that like mental crisis that I feel like every fantasy manager knows all too well. Like, do I actually know like how to play this game? Am I just terrible? And then I've eventually righted the ship. But yeah, this so far in the first, what are we in, like 3 days into the season here? Yeah, so far things are going okay. Buoyed by Jack Eichel going off and some other guys, Mr. Matt Boldy, Zach Werenski, all the A&G favorites are doing that.
This has been a vibe, man. Like all the guys we talked about, I feel like they're flying right now. It's amazing. So yeah, it's been really good. But that's so funny what you said too, because this is such a stressful time as a fantasy manager. You're like, oh, I got to drop this guy. Do I need to pick him up like right now? Do I need to? It's like, you know, you drafted the guy, like maybe just hang on to him for a little bit, give him a few games, you know, before you drop him. But, you know, now we're going to tell you which guys to drop and you can blame us for all your, you know, pain.
That's right. That's what we're here for. We are also here for the newsies.
We got to talk about NHL news. Newsies! Oh, yeah. All right. Let's get into it. Sorry, everybody. I'm trying to work on my mic control. I'm trying to get further away from the mic, the louder I get. So, I'm working on that. I've got a specialist here, speech therapy. I'm losing it. All right. Let's start over in Buffalo, the 0-3 Buffalo Sabres. Oh, Mr. Ruff, say it isn't so. Talking about JJ Paterka here. What is his name? Jason John or John Jason? You remember?
One of the two. Yes.
Yeah, Jason John Paterka. That's what we're going to call him, regardless if that's his actual name. Yeah, he got a DNP on Thursday here, but he is practicing with the team, which is a great sign. And it looks like he's trending towards playing on Saturday. So definitely just keep an eye on that. You want to get him back in your lineups because, you know, Lindy Ruff's doing some weird stuff with the lines there. But I would imagine Paterka is still going to get power play one, which I think is like the premier spot. But definitely check out the line combinations, too, because Ruff is he's putting things in a blender early and he's tooting in all our faces. But that's fine. Buffalo's going to be fine. They're getting a ton of chances. They're just not getting the job done, are they, Nate?
Yeah, I tweeted about it, but Tage Thompson had 15 shot attempts, 10 scoring chances the other night against LA. So I think that the goals will come. I'm not too worried about it. I am a little bit worried about just like the team getting down on themselves. It feels still like a young team that could happen to. But overall, I think they're doing some of the right things. And yeah, it's a new coach. Maybe it takes a little bit of time for everything to come together.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm not too concerned at this point, but yeah, just keep an eye on it. Get ready to get JJ Paterka back in your lineup. John Jason Paterka. Jason, I lost it. All right, let's move over to Columbus. Unfortunately, this is horrible news. Like just, you know, Boone Jenner is going to be out until March, Nate. This is insane. I hate this. You know, Boone Jenner placed on the IR. Dmitry Voronkov as well. Pretty exciting young player placed on the IR. So, you know, it's already slim there in Columbus. This hurts a lot. Yeah, like Voronkov, he's expected back by the end of November, it looks like. But Jenner, yeah, he had shoulder surgery. He's going to be out for months. And it sounds like they're looking at March 1st, which is an outdoor game, for the target date. Like, I don't know if I've ever seen an update like that. Like, I think he's going to be ready for March 1st. It's like, oh, yeah. Do you, Don Waddell? Like, you know, he's Boone Jenner. He'll be back in a couple of weeks. All right. Don't worry about it. He doesn't need that shoulder. He's just going to throw his body in front of a bunch of pucks and, you know, help us win our fantasy leagues. This is terrible. But yeah, I mean, it just opens it up for other guys there. We were talking about this offline, but Kent Johnson got like 18 minutes deployment the other night. Hopefully, you know, Fantilli follows there. Like, he only got 15 the other night. So just some interesting deployment you want to watch in Columbus. But we still got our boy ZW, Zach Werenski, popping the hell off. 26 minutes for him. I'm just going off on the Columbus Blue Jackets. Actually, they played a pretty damn good game the other night. Like, you know, the shots four percentage, the Corsi four percentage, like, pretty even. And, you know, for a team that is kind of decimated already. Anyways, I'm going off of Columbus. That's not news, all right? But Columbus, all the best. Let's move on over to Florida. Nate's sleeper of the year, the craziest call of all time. Adam Boqvist took a puck in the face, but he did return to practice with a face shield on Thursday after, yeah, like I said, took a puck in the face. So he didn't play on Thursday, but sounds like he might get in on Saturday. And if he does, he'll get the top power play again. I think they're pretty committed to that. So great call by you, my man. But in his stead, Uvis Balzinkis, all right, that common household name, took top power play duties. I mean, you got Aaron Ekblad there. You got Gustav Forsling. No, we're going with Balzinkis because it makes perfect sense. And they just won the Stanley Cup, so no one can say anything, right? You're like, all right, well, Paul Maurice, you want to do that? Yeah, you obviously see something in Balzinkis. So anyways, Boqvist is going to get power play one if he's back in the lineup, so check that out. But still with Florida, though, obviously Barkov had that injury there, trying to, his stick broke at the blue line when he's trying to take a shot. They had an empty net there, and then he skates back to try and stop Timmy Stutes. He should have known you can't do that. You can't stop Timmy Stutes. And then he smashed himself into the boards, needed help to get off the ice. So, we did get some good news there, though. Just that he was able to walk, you know, on his own after the game. So it looks like, we'll probably get updates on Friday, or that was today. So yeah, we'll get more updates as we go on, but it sounds like he's going to be out for a little bit, but maybe dodge the bullet there. Moving over to Nashville, UC Saros, the Juice Tiger, missed the season opener. That stinks, but yeah, he was on the ice earlier in the day. I mean, he's just battling something small, it seems like to me, but yeah, I mean, I think Nashville's a great team. They didn't really show it the other night, but I mean, I think Scott Wedge was a good stream for now, if you need to. But yeah, Saros, he should be back and good to go, back to his workhorse ways. But yeah, something to keep an eye on. What about our boy Macklin Celebrini? Guy goes out and gets the goal of the year candidate, panorama off some man's skate. And then, yeah, now he's being evaluated for an unknown issue and he's questionable for Saturday's game. So I don't know. Did you watch any of Celebrini's first game there, Nate?
I only saw the highlights, but yeah. I've seen some of the stuff through the preseason too. Like, the kid's ready. Hope he can get healthy and not have his rookie season marred by injury.
Yep, absolutely. Love the player. I mean, hopefully he's good to go here. But yeah, when they say unknown issue, I don't know, that kind of irks me a bit. It's like, just tell us what's going on. You know what I mean? So that leads me to believe it might be, I don't know, something a little more significant. I don't know. Don't quote me on that. Over to Pittsburgh, Rusty, Brian Rust. He missed the first two games there in Pittsburgh, but he's been skating and traveling with the team. He's going to be day-to-day. So what they do when Rust is out, Raquel. Oh, he's on a strange erotic journey from Milan to Minsk all the way to the Pittsburgh power play one, and he's doing jack crap on there. Buddy, help us out. Hit something. But that's fine. Raquel's still going to be a good stream, you know, maybe hold even if he can stick on power play one there. But yeah, we'll talk about them a little bit later. But it's good that Rust is traveling with the team. He's our boy. He's our 70-point boy. So hopefully that, you know, he gets back in the lineup here. And buddy, what's going on with your goaltenders over there in Toronto? Joseph Wall, I mean, a stiff breeze knocked him over and he got some back tightness. I mean, what's going on over there?
Yeah, I mean, I wrote it in the note here on YouTube, if you're watching, that Wall is crumbly. It It just feels like this guy can't be touched, or he just like starts to melt or something. Like, yeah, it's really disappointing because he has actually played really well when he's healthy. It just seems like he can't stay healthy at all. And yeah, at some point you start to worry about chronic lower body issues for goaltenders, right? We've heard lots of people talk about how, yeah, there's just ways that you can't physically stretch, and it takes a lot of wear and tear to play a full season in the NHL. So yeah, I'm hoping the best for Joseph Woll, but obviously opens the door for Anthony Stolarz and the Hildebeest, Dennis Hildeby.
Hildebeest. I call him David. It's David Hildebeest, but that's fine. Not a terrible tandem, honestly. And Toronto's, as we know, should still be a good defensive environment for their goalies. So both rosterable guys, if you're streaming goalies in, obviously Stolarz is the person you want there. But yeah, hopefully Woll is back sooner rather than later. I think he's the 1A if he's healthy. Sticking with tendies, spicy tendies, Ilya Sorokin, buddy. He's not playing yet. There's a bit of mystery surrounding this guy. He's backing up Semyon Varlamov for the games, but yeah, he's still not ready to play. It sounds like he's not going to play the next game either. So yeah, it's just a kind of an interesting start there. And then you look at last year with Patrick Waugh, the way he was playing Semyon Varlamov as well. Like, I don't know. I'm not reading too much into it, but I'm mildly concerned, right? But Sorokin was a major value in drafts this year. Like, I got him in round 11 in a non-zero G league. You know what I mean? Like, people are like, no, I'm not interested. So if this is just a week thing or a week or two and he gets back to business as a number one, like, that's a smash. This guy's, he's a top five goalie in the league. So hopefully he can get back to business there. But in the meantime, Varlamov, he's your Huckleberry. Over to the Avs, Jonathan Drouin is battling an upper body injury. He's going to miss the next few games as per Coach Bednar. He was skating on line one, power play one. So yeah, that opens up some deployment there. For some guys, maybe Kovalenko jumps up there. I mean, guys like Mittelstadt and Ross Colton now potentially on power play one. Seems like they got it locked down. So we'll talk about that a little bit later. Just something to keep an eye on. And then in other Avs news, they claimed Kaapo Kähkönen off of waivers, which is a very strange move because they got Justus Ahonen, who is not waivers exempt. So now they're just going to carry three goalies. Like, I don't know. What do you make of that, Nate?
Yeah, I really don't know what to make of that, to be honest. Maybe it's organizational depth and they're going to try to send Kähkönen down and see if they can sneak him through waivers. Maybe. I really don't know. But yeah, interesting spot, and obviously throws some damper on any potential there. Georgiev did not look good in his first game. You got to think Ahonen is going to get his chance at some point. But yeah, it just muddies the waters at this point. And that's something that's really tough to deal with if you're trying to roster any goalie there. I mean, obviously the counterpoint to that is the Colorado net is super valuable. If any player comes away with a lion's share of those starts, it's going to be fantasy relevant.
Yep, got to keep an eye on the Avs net there. And then lastly, game here on Saturday between Carolina and Tampa Bay has been canceled due to Hurricane Milton's effects on the Tampa region. So yeah, I mean, that's awful. Our thoughts are definitely with anyone affected by that natural disaster there. And hopefully, it passes as quickly as possible with this, minimal effect on people's lives as possible. But yeah, just a stinky situation there in Tampa. But that is it for the news. Nate, we got to talk about, we got to see what kind of games are going on this week in a little segment we like to call Schedule Attack.
The schedule attack is our new favorite segment, at least mine. I shouldn't speak for you, Blake, but it's definitely my new favorite segment just for the name alone, basically.
Exactly. Yeah.
But
gotta attack that schedule.
Let's attack that schedule. Monday, we got 6 games. Tuesday, we have 9 games. Wednesday, we have 4 games. Thursday, we have 11 games. Friday, 3 games. Saturday, 13 games. Sunday, 3 games. In total, we have 49 games played. That's a light week in total. Generally, I like to think of anything like 50 or below is a light week. 51 to 54, somewhere around there, is kind of a normal week. Anything 55 or beyond that is probably a heavy week. So this is a bit of a light week overall. You're probably going to be able to work some guys in. You know, the 9-game Tuesday isn't technically an off night, but you can probably fit a streamer in on the Tuesday, at least one somewhere. So something to keep in mind. Two teams have the Monday, Tuesday back-to-back to open the week. If you're looking for a quick stream to get ahead, Florida and New Jersey are those two teams. There's definitely going to be some opportunity there. With the Barkov injury, you got to think Anton Lundell moves up the list in terms of ice time. He had a really solid game under the hood, his first game for Florida here. So I'm actually low-key pretty interested in Anton Lundell, at least for those first two games, and just see how those go. And then you can make your decision what you want to do after that. Five teams have Monday, Wednesday to open the week. So the two off nights there, if you don't have any free space on the Tuesday, those five teams are Boston, Colorado, Los Angeles, Pittsburgh, and Utah. There are three teams with Wednesday, Friday off nights: Anaheim, Colorado, Pittsburgh. Five teams with Friday, Sunday off nights: Anaheim, Colorado, Pittsburgh, San Jose, and Winnipeg. We got two teams here, Colorado and Pittsburgh, with that coveted four games, four off night schedule, where you're absolutely assured you're going to be able to fit those players in your lineup. So definitely some options from those two teams. With the Druin injury, obviously opens up some more space for some other players to gain some fantasy relevance as a streamer this week. So definitely you're going to want to be interested in what those teams can offer you. There's a few different ways you can really get the most out of your ads this week that I'd like to point out. So obviously you got the Florida or New Jersey. If you do have that Monday, Tuesday back-to-back, if you can make that work on the Tuesday, you do that, and then you switch over into either Anaheim, Colorado, or Pittsburgh. That'll get you five games played. So that's definitely a good way to get five games played out of a single streamer spot. Boston or Utah into San Jose or Winnipeg can get you four off nights if you need solely on the off nights. So there's definitely a lot of ways to skin the cat this week, a lot of different ways that you can kind of maximize what you need to do in your lineup. So definitely take a look and see what you can do. Blake, we got to move over to another segment that we like to call Lowered Expectations.
Lower those expectations, people. This segment here is the worst teams to stream and potential bubble players that you might want to drop, right? And we'll just go through those teams and the potential players. Okay, here we go. All right, so there are two teams with clearly the worst schedule for this upcoming week here, and they are Calgary and Minnesota. They both have two games played with zero off nights. So that's gonna be really tough. That's going to hamper you here. They both play Tuesday and Saturday, right? So maybe if you can get a player in on that Tuesday from your Calgary or Minnesota team, like maybe you hold them for the Tuesday and then you bounce them after that, right? But let's dig in a little bit on some of these players here, starting with the Flames. Nate, I'll just give you a few players here and just give me your thoughts on some of these players and what you're doing with them. And right off the bat, I mean, Rasmus Anderson, like there's good players on Calgary, good fantasy players, or, you know, rosterable fantasy players, guys like Rasmus Anderson, Blake Coleman, Andre Kuzmenko, even Jonathan Huberto. What are you doing with those players?
Yeah. And I think in a lot of, you know, standard 12 team, like if you're doing a Yahoo league where you have 10 starting spots in your starting roster, four defense, six forwards, and then usually like four bench, I think I'm probably dropping all those guys. Anderson, Coleman, Kuzmenko, Huberto. I really don't think I just don't think I'm going to get burned by that really in the end, right? So if there is one of these players from, you know, the Colorado or Pittsburgh, that's a really high priority player, we'll talk about them later. But if there is like a high priority streamer out there, I would not feel bad whatsoever about dropping any of those guys for one of those players.
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, Rasmus Anderson is 72% rostered on Yahoo. That's an interesting one. But like something we talk about all last year and we'll talk about again this year is like, when I think about drops, I think about, is someone going to rush to the wire and pick this guy up and be like, what the hell is this guy doing dropping, you know, so-and-so? And I think the answer with these four players is no, right? Yeah. Even Rasmus Anderson, you drop him, people are like, okay, you know, block streamer. Like, yeah, he had a goal the other night or assist or whatever it was. But I'm not too worried about dropping these players here. And then, buddy, what about our boy, the popsicle. Martin Pospisil. Yeah, I mean, you know, I guess we got to drop him as well. I mean, he's definitely worse than those players that we mentioned. But he had a nice little debut game there this season. Goal and an assist. Nice. Yeah, he's paired with Huberto there. So it's a nice line. Mantha actually looked pretty good too. But yeah, I think I was talking to you. Like, I'm in a couple bangers leagues with Pims. And I've got Pospisil on both those teams. I don't think I'm going to be dropping Pospisil because I think the value is too high. And I think that someone would be like, you know, maybe someone who's dominating, like they're projected to win their week massively. It'd be like, yeah, I'll take a hit and go grab Martin Pospisil. Right. So
right.
I just think there's a lot of value there. So in that type of format, I might not drop Martin Pospisil unless I absolutely have to. But I mean, we're looking at it like a 35 point player here, folks. So, yeah. You know, it's that's what we're looking at. But shout out to Martin Pospisil. The man's a legend. He's got a tinted visor as well. I'm digging that. That's giving me Ovi vibes, right? I don't know. Why doesn't Ovi do that anymore? Remember, he used to have those crazy skates too. Does he still have that? I don't know. I don't watch enough Washington. I'm hating on Ovi all year this year. Terrible. Best goal scorer of all time. All right, let's move on. We got to talk about the Minnesota Wild. Different vibe here, but still some players that are on the bubble. I think the player that people might have the most questions about is Matt Zuccarello. You know, obviously he's got power play one, and that is uber valuable here for fantasy. He got a goal in the opening game there. What are you doing with the zucchini man?
I think I'm holding him, to be honest. As long as he's on the top line with Kaprizov, as long as he's on the top power play, I think you got to hold on to Zuccarello. That chemistry is still there. It's not going away. I mean, I kind of feel like Rock could have chemistry with Kaprizov, but definitely there's something there between the two players, and Zuccarello does seem to, just completely go off every time he's alongside Kaprizov. So as long as he's still there, that being said, like if we get, you know, if that game next week, the first game doesn't go well and they switch up the lines and Boldy takes his place on the top line, then I'm really thinking about it, right? So it is much more deployment dependent for me with Zuccarello than it's ever been in the past.
Yeah, for sure. Did you say The Rock could have chemistry with like Dwayne The Rock Johnson? Is that what you're
implying? That wasn't what I was going for, but yeah.
I mean, he's a good athlete. I think he could. Like, yeah, I don't know if he can skate. I mean, we'll have to put a pin in that. Definitely check that out later. But anyways, I'm holding Zucchini Man as well. You got to do it. All right. Because he's bringing us that fantasy goodness. But people I'm probably not holding for next week, Ryan Hartman, Marco Rossi. I mean, I like the ceiling for Marco Rossi. I like the deployment. He's not getting power play one, but yeah, line one with cap. That's again, like we just said, and it's another year of development for a really talented player. That would hurt a little bit because I like Rossi for that upside play, but I mean, if you want to win your week, you can't just be holding for upside players. So yeah, that's what I'm doing with Hartman Rossi. What do you think, Nate?
Yep. Totally agree.
Yep. Get out of my sight. All right. We don't need those players. All right. And Hartman's a dingus to boot. So there you go. Don't let the door hit you on the way out, my man. Just kidding. He's a good player. Let's move on to the next team. The Toronto Maple Leafs. Nate's whole roster is just going to be nuked because he's such a homer in fantasy. But yeah, they have two games played with one off night. So yeah, it's going to be a rough go for Toronto there. So they play on the Wednesday and the Saturday. So yeah, I mean, you're still not getting the Monday, Tuesday. Like it's hard to hold the fringe players on Toronto. And the good thing is like, they don't have that many, right? Like the main one that I think we're looking at here is Matthew Knies. Right. The guy had a monster game there. First game with Craig Berube. What was your take on Knies and what are you doing with him this week there, Nate?
Yeah, I'm thinking about this when I have him in the Apples and Geos Patron League, which is a pretty deep league. And obviously Knies, he does hit. He's shown he's got 8 shots in the first 2 games here. So he's adding that at least in the first 2 games. And so I'm going to have a real decision on my hands as to what I'm going to do with him next week. I honestly haven't made up my mind yet. You know, there's always a chance that injuries happen or something over the weekend and kind of makes the decision for me. But, I really don't know yet what I'm doing with Knies in that situation. And that's a pretty deep league. We go three center, three left wing, three right wing in that league with the utility spot. So, yeah, I'm trying to hang on to Nyes because I am pretty intrigued by the early returns here, and especially in a bangers format, he brings that as well. So I'm trying to hang on to Nyes just to see what's going on here. It does seem like Berube is actually going to play him a lot more at even strength than Keith Ether did. And so that's the part that's got me intrigued. The shot volume is up. The time on ice is up. I'm trying to not be out on players who were legitimately good prospects and are now getting a pretty good run alongside two of the biggest superstars in the game.
Absolutely. Yeah. No, I like the way it's trending there. I tend to agree. I don't have him anywhere, but yeah, it's just the type of player that someone would be like, again, go out and pick up Matthew Nyes if you look at what he's been able to do, or at least in that first game there. So, yeah, I like the player trending upwards. OEL. I think he's a pretty clear drop. Maximus Domius. Max Domi, get the hell out of my sight. I mean, no, those guys are streamer level, and I think you could, if you really wanted them, they'll probably still be there when you go back to the wire. So yeah, that's it for Toronto. Moving on, the next team with a pretty poor schedule is Winnipeg. They only play two games, but they're both on the off nights, which is, you know, is valuable, right? And those off nights are Friday, Sunday, as Nate mentioned. So Winnipeg is a back half team for sure. Like, I think you're going to want to drop your Winnipeg streamers for the beginning of the week. And then, yeah, you fly at it for Friday, right? You pick them up and you dodge that busy Saturday. But in terms of the players on Winnipeg, yeah, like, what are you doing? Because one of the guys, this is a guy we talked about a little bit this offseason, Gabe Vilardi, right? He's 43% rostered. He's getting line one, power play one, hasn't really done too much with it, right? Had an assist in the first game, but he did have 20 and a half minutes. Just in the game here tonight, which is Friday night. I mean, three shots on goal, nothing to write home about, but I like the deployment. It's line one, power play one. And it's kind of hard to get off a player like that. Like, I think he's under rostered at 43 or whatever I said it was. So what are you doing with Gabe Vilardi?
Yeah, I have Vilardi and Kukoffel. I have Vilardi and Coleman, and I have Kaprizov and Boldy. I'm going to be in tough to put some games played in that league next week. But yeah, that's a player that I am trying to hang on to as well. I really think that Vilardi could have a 30-plus goal season this year, and those guys don't grow on trees. So getting 20 minutes a night, if that's going to be what we can expect every night, absolutely. That's a player that I don't think you can let go just because he has a couple of games, only two games in a single week.
Yep, agreed. But it stinks. You know, we're like, oh, God, I got to hold Gabe Vilardi for two-game week? Oh, man. At least you'll get him into those games. That's nice. Then some of the other streamers, Neil Pionk, get the hell out of my sight. Mom Spaghetti, Cole Perfetti, what are you doing out there, my man? Are you even playing the game? I like this player, but man, he's not getting prioritized. And also, just as an aside, they're not giving Ehlers the minutes, Nate. They're not doing it. Mr. Arneal, like, just, he needs 18. Just give him 18 minutes. I don't get it. The guy's got two assists. Like, you know, let the man fly. Free Ehlers, hashtag. But that's a story for another pod. Anyways, you drop in Pionk and Perfetti pretty clearly.
Yes.
Sweet. All right. And then lastly, there are 12 teams that have three games with zero off nights. So I'm not going to go through all those, but you're definitely going to have to look at, you know, your schedule and see where you can fit them in. But again, remember that Tuesday is a 9-game Tuesday. You might be able to get some players in there. So yeah, just plan accordingly. You got to get your spreadsheets, right, Nate? You got to get the spreadsheets going. You got to, you know, you got to get the biz on that, right? And if you can't, just call Nate. All right. I have him do all my work. Basically, I'm like a shell corporation for like your fantasy knowledge. So yeah, Nate gets proceeds of my profits and stuff if I win. So it's a whole thing, but I don't know. It works for us, right, Nate?
Yeah, it's great. You're based in the Cayman Islands. It just makes everything work so much better there.
Yeah, absolutely, buddy. All right. That's it. We're lowering our expectations. Now we got to bump those expectations up, and we got to go and we got to cross the streams, buddy. Nate, remember that last time we crossed the streams and remember the sun just came over the mountain and it was sunrise and a bird, like a beautiful bird, just flew off a tree. I think it was an eagle. It made that sound, you know, and then I looked over there and there was a frog on a lily pad. You remember that?
It was one of the most seminal moments of my life. Yeah, how could I forget?
Yeah, absolutely, buddy. And we crossed the streams like men, all right? And it felt amazing, and we're going to do it again right here for you folks. All right, these are the best teams that we want to stream for this week right here. And as Nate mentioned, we got a couple beauty teams here. Perfect streaming weeks for Colorado and Pittsburgh. Four games played, four off nights. We're loving it. So, you know, if you can, like if you're up in your matchups, try and grab one of these studs now, right? Because they're going to dry up pretty fast. But it is nice that there's two teams with this because, yeah, I think these streamers are going to be plentiful, right? So let's start with Colorado. Obviously, you got to keep an eye on Jonathan Drouin and his injury there. If he can get in for three games, like, or if you can add a player to your, you know, IR plus or whatever, right off waivers, maybe that's an option. I'm not saying do that, but we need more information on Drouin's injury before I would suggest picking him up, but take a look there. But I think, the true value for streamers in Colorado is going to be Casey Mittelstadt. And to me, it's going to be Ross Colton. Those two players are the guys that I'm targeting right off the bat because they're getting power play one deployment, or they're projected to, right? They ran with Ross Colton on power play one in practice today. So we're here for it. Nate, are we excited about this or what?
Every time that Ross Colton gets a little bit more deployment, like my
rate stats fall off a cliff.
Well, yeah, that happens, but yeah, I was going to say my heart rate actually increases slightly. So I can't quit the man. The underlying stats are just too good. I'm tenting up over here.
Oh my God. Yeah. Like camping. That's what we're talking about, right?
Yeah.
Again, it's across the streams reference, right? We're out in the lake, you know what we're doing. But yeah, Ross Colton, I mean, buddy, pretty sweet. I picked him up in a banger league that I have. That I'm winning handily. So I'm excited for some Ross Colton next week. I think it's going to be really good. We don't know how long Drouin's going to be out. So again, just keep an eye on that. But yeah, man, Mittelstadt too. Good offensive player, right? Doesn't show out in the metrics we like here, but does show out in the microstats metrics that I look at with Corey Schneider's all three zones. He's really good at generating chances and shots, right? Just not his own chances or his own shots. He doesn't do that, all right? But he's got a beautiful head of hair, and that's confirmed. Some other options there. How about Nikolai Kovalenko, right? He's getting some run on the top line there. Josh Manson, like, what do you think about Kovalenko on the top line? You think there's some value there?
Yeah, I mean, there obviously is, right? He's playing with McKinnon and Rantanen. There's going to be value there. I just don't know how much we can really trust it, right? That's the part that's a little bit scary is, like, does this last for one period and then it's gone again? It's definitely within the range of outcomes. That being said, like, I'm going to take that swing because, like, even if there is one period, like, he could have 2 points in one period of play on that line and it wouldn't shock anyone. So I'm going to take that swing, especially in deeper leagues. But it's definitely a guy that there's a lot of risk. You could be looking at this after one game and being like, yeah, I kind of wasted that ad.
Yeah. That's one of those guys that's iffy to me. It's like a pick that I do when I'm like sitting on the toilet at like 11:30 at night. And I'm like, oh yeah, I can get Andre or Nikolai Kovalenko. And then I wake up in the morning. I'm like, why did I do that? I wasted a move. This guy, now he's on line three. He's like, he's filling up the water bottles. I don't know. But that is a good player with some decent acumen that obviously Jared Bednar likes. You know, he's deployed him in the top six a little bit in the preseason here. So interesting player. Josh Manson, obviously, he's more of a beefer, you know, for your banger league. So some options there in Colorado, which is nice. And then over to the Dirty Bird, the Pittsburgh Penguins. We got to talk about the Bunt Cake, Michael Bunting. What the hell? They lied to me. They said Michael Bunting was going to be on power play one to start the season. And then, you know, they just crop dusted their farticles right over my face. And I'm, you know, what are we doing here? But, you know, Bunting, like, I still think he's going to be a great streamer. Like, I think he got like 16 minutes or something in the first game, you know, line two, power play two. That's enough, right? If you're getting four games out of Michael Bunting, he's going to be able to provide you something there. I think the better streamer, though, is probably our boy, Rickard Rakell, right? Because he's getting that top power play. You know, he usually bangs pretty good. He hasn't really been doing that too much so far. But, yeah, I think Rakell, I'd probably go Rakell, Bunting. And then Anthony Beauvillier, they got him up with Crosby. And he's actually doing stuff. He's shooting he's shooting the puck. So, I'm pretty good on those players there. I mean, and then your boy, Drew O'Connor. Talk to me about Drew O'Connor, Nate.
Yeah, I mean, the guy's averaging over 16 minutes a night. He's always had decent underlying numbers. This last game, he played with Malkin. He has played with Crosby in the past. He's played there when with Rust at the end of last season, both of those guys with Crosby. So, yeah, just a player that I think the organization likes a lot more than any fantasy manager does. And so it's just a guy that I'm keeping an eye on in more deep formats for sure, but definitely a guy that I think can produce. Right now, he's ranked 19th in the league in individual scoring chances, 4 per 60. Anthony Beauvillier first in shots per 60. That due to the fact that he's under 14 and a half minutes a night for the first two nights, but for sure, there's some value to be had in Pittsburgh, and especially in deeper leagues.
Yeah. How would you rank those four?
Yeah, I think you got to go Raquel as long as he's on the top power play. I will say, like, if and when Russ comes back, who does he bump off the top power play? Because I do think he goes straight back there. Is it Raquel that he bumps, or is it Chris Letang who's been on the top power play as of late? I don't really have a good sense of that. I would guess Raquel, just because Raquel hasn't done anything. And obviously the organization loves Chris Letang for everything that he's done. So that's my best guess, but it is a guess. I'm not claiming to prognosticate that anymore. But I think that, yeah, I think you go Raquel if he's on the top power play. Hopefully we get some sort of idea of that before you actually have to make a decision. I think Bunting is probably the slightly more interesting player. He's the early stats, underlying stats are a little bit better for him as well. And then, yeah, you have to think about Beauvillier just seemingly getting some attachment to Crosby in the early going here. I do think that even if Russ goes back on the top line, it's probably Beauvillier on the other side. So I think I'd throw in Beauvillier third and then O'Connor fourth.
There you go. From the mouth of the legend right there. All right. Now you know what to do. All right. And especially if you're in a league with him, you can just go pick those players up immediately. and just, yeah, that's fine. All right. Let's move on. So those are your two teams with the perfect schedule. Moving over to the LA Kings. They have a 4-game schedule with 3 off nights. So yeah, that's the next best thing there. They play Monday, Wednesday, Thursday. So they have the back-to-back Wednesday, Thursday, and then they play on Sunday. So yeah, if you can get him in on a Thursday, which is an 11-game Thursday, that's a 4-game week, so definitely check that out. But they've got some good streamers. I mean, reasonable streamers, right? Depending on your format as well. But one of the guys, like, I think we're still looking at here is Brandt Clark, right? I mean, he did get power play 1 there in game 1, as expected. But also as expected, he got 17 minutes time on ice in the whole game, right? Which, that's not going to cut it, right?
Yeah.
That's Will Butcher numbers. That's Tony D'Angelo numbers. We don't need that. All right. We need Lane Hudson numbers. All right. Get him up over 20. I think we're looking at a real player here. I mean, this year, I mean, but yeah, Brandt Clark. I mean, what is, are you still prioritizing Brandt Clark a little bit, even with that 17 minutes there in this first game with LA?
Yeah, I mean, it's 1 game. I want to get a little bit more of a sample size here to really see where we're at. I don't think he's going to be a 20-minute player, but if he can be an 18, 19-minute player, then that becomes a lot more palatable for sure. And yeah, it's a player that I think has the chops to eventually grow that role even more throughout the season. It's a player that the coach has already spoken highly of in the preseason. They're going to try to do this the right way with them and not just throw him in off the deep end and try to bring him along in the right way. But I think it's a player that still has sky high offensive potential, and you just have to be somewhat in on that. Yeah, if he continues to only see 15, 16 minutes a night for the next like 5 games, for sure that takes the shine off it. But if it does start to tick up even a little bit, then I'm going to become more and more interested.
Yep. This is a great week to experiment with Brandt Clark. The Brandt Clark experience. I think you need to get on that, right? Because he's got a great week and let's see what he can do, right? Then some other players there on LA. You've got Tanner Jeannot, who's going to be your beefer. So for banger leagues, this guy's going to pop off this week with hits at the very least. You know, he's never going to touch 20 goals again, this guy. How did Tanner Jeannot get 20 goals? Like, what were people just shooting it off of his body? Was he just standing there and like guys were just dinking it off his, you know, his cup or something like that? Like this massive cup, you know what I'm talking about? Like, I don't know where I'm going with that. Oh God, Nate, that's fine. I'm drinking a beer here. 1 beer. And this is the outcome. Phil Deneau, right. The 3C there in LA, reasonable. Right. Yep. Never an exciting streamer to me, but the guy is so consistent. Like, you know what you're getting there, right? And then an interesting one to me, Alex LeFerrier, you know, your favorite player from a projection episode, who I correctly called as the number one left winger there. I didn't correctly call him to do anything there. But, you know, what do you – like, so we'll give you LeFerrier and then McLovin, Warren Fogel as your streamers there. How are you ranking those players, Nate?
Yeah, it's tough to get excited about LeFerrier. He had an assist, but he didn't have any shots. So that's a little bit concerning. Again, one game, I'm not going to make any huge pronouncements. He's still on that Kopitar Kempe line. He's still on the top power play. That's worth something. Definitely, yep. You have to take that into account. And you definitely should. You should be on your radar for this week for sure. Yeah, I guess I think I would still take Deneau first for the sure thing there. I just feel like Deneau's not going to let me down. Every time I stream him for four games, he gets me 2 or 3 points, and he has a bunch of shots and has a bunch of blocks. He does all the things that I need. So I think I would go Deneau first. Then I go to LeFerrier, and then I go to Fogel. And Jadeau, obviously, is just a beggar's option.
Yeah, absolutely. And just of note as well, like Quinton Byfield and Trevor Moore, they're rostered in the 60s, right? So in good leagues, they should be rostered. But yeah, I mean, if they're not rostered, those guys should be added for this week for sure. Like Byfield at 63, I don't get it. Like, he played 19 minutes. He looked really good. I like what's going on there. So I think he could have a nice season here. Definitely should be higher rostered than 63. Let's move on. Sticking in California. All right, San Jose, they've got a 4-game, 2 off-night schedule here. San Jose plays Tuesday, Thursday, which are their busy nights, but then they play the Friday, Sunday, so they dodge the busy Saturday. And they do have some streamers. They got some guys that I'm interested in, right, that we were talking about in our projection show, and they're probably all still available, right? So first off the hop, I mean, Tyler Toffoli, what is this man doing on your waivers? You got to pick up Tyler Toffoli. And every time I talk about Tyler Toffoli, I got to remember Tonya Harding's bodyguard, Jeff Galooly. You know what I'm talking about? And were you alive when this happened? Do you know who Tonya Harding is?
I know who Tonya Harding is, but I don't know the bodyguard's name. I'm sorry to disappoint.
I'm so alone. that's fine. You know the highest rostered player on San Jose? Macklin Celebrini at 57%. So these guys are all out there, right? So you got Tyler Toffoli. He definitely should be an ad. Mikhail Granlund is out there. Will Smith, the Fresh Prince. And then Wild Bill, William Eklund. You gotta get, he played 21 minutes the other night. I mean, Jake Wallman, Fabian Zetterlund. Talk to me about some of your favorite streamers on San Jose here, Nate.
Yeah, I love all these names. Obviously, Toffoli, 50% rostered. He's probably gone in more competitive leagues, but definitely just go check. The one that I'm pretty interested in here is Granlund, just a guy that the coaching staff there has always trusted. Last year, they played him an insane amount of minutes. This year, they're probably going to scale that back a bit, but it's still going to be like 18 plus every single night. Yep. So definitely you can find some value with Granlund. There's Will Smith, if you want to take a stab at him. The first game wasn't like anything special or anything to write home about, but do think that there's a chance that he could pop. Eklund getting that kind of deployment is obviously interesting. Zetterlund is a guy that we streamed at times last year. So I think that's the way I go at Toffoli. If he's out there, Granlund next, Eklund following him, Zetterlund, and then Smith at the end. Jake Wallman, super interesting, though. That's a guy that should be rostered in way more leagues. I think 11% rostered right now, which is pretty atrocious, to be honest. And he's going to come up later as well.
Yeah, it's true. Oh, man. There was one league I was in where I was waiting on Jake Wallman. I'm like, okay, no, I think he's going to come back around. I think he's going to come back around because he was showing really high in my projections. And then someone drafted him. Oh, I felt terrible. Because I am abnormally high on Jake Wallman as well. I think that's a guy that's going to have a really nice year for fantasy. So yeah, definitely pick up any of these studs. I think it's really good, especially for the back half of your week, right? The Friday, Saturday is very valuable. So keep that in mind. Moving on, how about Anaheim? They play 3 games with 3 off-nights here, which is really nice. They play the Wednesday, Friday, Sunday. So, you know, maybe you could get, Florida or New Jersey, you get the back-to-back, then you jump on an Anaheim player. And again, you got 2 moves, 5 games, pretty damn nice. So let's look at some of the guys on Anaheim here. Starting with, you know, that angry Viking, Radko Gudas, one of the best names ever. He's out there. Obviously, his value is in banger leagues. So check your format. I mean, do people roster Radko Gudas in points leagues?
I've seen it done. It's not something I've done, but I have seen it done.
I don't know. Yeah, I've seen it too. I mean, even Kakupful, like where, you know, blocks are weighted pretty well, hits are, you know, 0.25 or whatever, but it's not enough. I'm not interested in that. But yeah, Cutter Gauthier, Mason McTavish, Trevor Zegras, Leo Carlson. Look at these names. Troy Terry, like of that forward group, who's really ringing your bell there?
Yeah, of the forward group, I mean, the way that they're splitting things up, it's just going to be, I feel like, a flavor of the week kind of thing. Obviously, I still like Terry, and I think that he's probably the most talented of these guys, so I think I'd take Terry at the top, but definitely I could see arguments for any of the others, Gauthier, McTavish, Zegras. I really like Leo Carlson. Yep. I think that there's a chance that we're going to see more and more minutes going Leo Carlson's way. We talked about that a little bit before the episode as well. And I do agree. I think that Leo Carlson could be getting 20-minute treatment as soon as like October here. So I think that that's a player to watch and a player that could actually exceed and go beyond the hellscape that is a Greg Cronin-led Anaheim Ducks squad.
Yep. So true, man. Yeah. Of those guys. Yeah. To me, it's Carlson and Terry. But yeah, like they're practicing with Terry on the third line right now. I don't know. I mean, Greg Cronin, get your head out of your A. All right, buddy. No. Yeah. Anyways, I like me some Leo Carlson. What about the D? That's a good question. That's what she said. Pavel Mentyakov, the fresh maker, Olin Zellweger. And I threw in Jackson Lacombe here, is actually getting power play one reps with the team. Of those three, how are you ranking those three studs?
Yeah, I have no interest really in Lacombe. Maybe he lucks into a point, but I don't think he's going to have any sort of... I don't think he's going to be a very efficacious player on the power play, to put it mildly. So, I'd still go Mentyakov as the only guy getting power play. It's still going to be a 1A, 1B thing in Anaheim. It's pretty clear from the units that they're putting together here. So I'd go Mentyakov first for sure. I would take Zellweger over Lacombe even with the power play.
God, I drafted Zellweger in a lot of drafters. And in best ball, like the A&G best ball as well. I'm like, yeah, mm-hmm. I'll get me some of those off nights. Zellweger, he's not even on the power play. What is Greg? Like, this is the power play is an advantage for your team. You have five, they have four. You put the best offensive players out and they score. I don't know. I got to get an email to Greg Cronin here. If anybody has his information, please send that along to Apples and Genos, at hotmail.com. I don't know. Where to go with that. Lots of good Anaheim streamers. Let's move on. Boston and Utah have three games with two off nights. So those are some nice options as well. Boston have the Monday, Wednesday, and then they play the busy Saturday. Same with Utah. So they have the same schedule there. You can start your week out with Boston and Utah. Really nice. And Utah has some bangers. We love our Utah hockey club here. Let's start with Utah because I like that. Dylan Guenther. Did anyone see this coming, Nate? Did anyone see Dylan Guenther coming? I mean, how just out of nowhere, blindsiding the NHL. What do you have to say for yourself?
Yeah, I mean, I think we talked about Guenther even at the end of last year. We were big on Guenther. He was a big part of a lot of Apples and Genos Discord members' teams, bringing them to a championship. And we're unreasonably high on him coming into this season as well. I think I talked about him before the season as having 40 goal upside, and I think that was a bit of a hot take, but it's coming true even faster than I thought. I will say, like, he got under 13 minutes in the last game, so like, take it for what it's worth. There are going to be some games. It was a bit of a weird game. I believe they were on the penalty kill for a pretty significant chunk of that game, so it was a bit of a weird game that way. I think more often he probably lives in the 15 to 16 minute range, but I do expect that to grow over the course of the season because I think that this is going to be the breakout party that we were hoping for from Dylan Guenther.
Yeah. Could he have had a better start? Like, scores the first goal in franchise history, and every puck off his stick is whipping. Like, his release is stupid. So this guy's for real, folks. I'm really into it. If this guy is somehow available in your league, he needs to be a priority. Like, this is a guy that you're holding all year. It's not just a streamer, right? So, yeah. I mean, you got to wait. You got a waiver priority. Number one, you go get Dylan Gunther and you do it now. All right. This guy could get 30 this year. He could get 40, maybe. I mean, damn. He's got that skill level. So anyways, we love Dylan Gunther here. And then Logan Cooley as well. I mean, come on. Like, then the guy's doing this. He's not even on power play one. Like, he's going to get power play one at some point this year. That's going to be really nice. So I think he's going to improve on his last season's numbers. Very talented player. Lawson Krause for beefers. You know, Nick Schmaltz, he's shooting the puck. What's going on with Nick Schmaltz? He he's pulling a Panarin over here. He's like, you know what? I'm just going to do something else because I'm Nick Schmaltz. And I don't give a damn. I can do that. So yeah, he looks good out there. I love that top line. And Barrett Hayton as well. So, I mean, talk to me just about how you would sort of prioritize those. Obviously we're going Gunther there, but talk to me about Schmaltz, Hayton, Krause, Cooley. How are you managing those players?
Yeah, I think I'm still going with Schmaltz first at this point. Like the extra shot volume, I don't think it sticks around. I think we know who Nick Schmaltz is at this point in time. Yeah. But I do think that he is the player that obviously has great chemistry with Keller. As long as he's healthy, he's going to be line one power play one. Barrett Hayton getting that line one power play one treatment as well, and so that's really interesting. I think I would take him second at this point, just because the minutes haven't really been there for Logan Cooley yet, and obviously it's hard to keep up a 2 assist per game pace when you're getting under 15 minutes a night. So I think that's where I'm at as of now. I would go Schmaltz, Hayton, Cooley, at least in the short term. If you're looking across the entire season, I might take Cooley over Hayton, just because I think that there's some upside where Cooley absolutely goes nuclear alongside Gunther and they're forced to play him like 18, 19 minutes a night, maybe 2 months into season or 3 months into the season. So there is that if you're just considering who you're going to hold on to for the entire season. But if you're looking at them more as a streamer for next week, as we're talking about here, I think I'd go Schmaltz, Hayton, Cooley, and then Krause at the end.
Yep. Makes sense to me, man. I like that. Hayton and Cooley kind of passing ships in the night. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I think it should be Cooley's team, and Hayton certainly has a great role with this team as a defensively responsible center that can facilitate, right? And he facilitates things for Schmaltz and Keller very well. So great stuff there. I mean, and then our boy, Sean Durzi, this guy got 26 minutes the other night. Mm-hmm. He's not getting the power play one treatment, but he's getting a boatload of minutes. So obviously that is going to raise the ceiling for Sean Durzi. I had a pretty damn healthy projection for him this year. One that I wanted to back off of. And then I was like, no, I'm not backing off of Sean Durzi. But I mean, I think I had him for 45 points or something, which probably a little bit spicy for Durzi. But if he's getting this kind of minutes, that's within reach to me.
Yep.
So there you go. So Durzi's out there. He's 40% rostered. So definitely take a look there. Boston as well. Let's just go through them really quickly. I mean, the usual suspects, right? We got Pavel Zacha, line one, power play one. What are we doing? Get this man on your team. I think he's dual eligible as well. So, that guy can do stuff for you. So get him in there. What about the Coiler? What about the Coiler? He filled the bowl. He flushed it and he filled it again. He does that. Yeah. I don't know. You know where I'm going with this. All right. We're talking. That's potty humor. All right. So anyways, Charlie Coyle, he's out there. Elias Lindholm, really nice start to the season for him. The metrics really aren't there, but I mean, the deployment and the opportunity are smashes for him. And I really do think this is a 70-point player this year with Boston. And he's had a great start. So if he's out there, I think you got to add him. Nikita Zadorov getting assists randomly. What's happening? I don't know. But, maybe he's following up his great playoffs with the Canucks. And maybe that's just the player he is now. He's getting prioritized a little bit there. And he's really good, man. Like, he was a difference maker for the Canucks. I don't know if he can sustain it all season, but I mean, he looks good in Boston there. I'm happy about that. And then Trent Frederick. I don't think I've ever rostered Trent Frederick in any league ever. Have you, Nate?
I have, yeah. Oh my Bangers God. League. He's center right wing, brings that. He scored a goal already. Usually shoots okay, hits pretty good, throws in a casual block here or there. Definitely in deeper leagues, he's worth shouting out. Deeper banger leagues.
One of you and Trent Frederick get a room, Nate. Damn it. That's fine. Yeah, great player. Actually, I like that banger angle. All right. Last team here. I swear, folks, I'm yammering on, but we're gonna end this soon. All right. End the bleeding. Florida and New Jersey both play four games with one off night. And like we said, they both start the week with a back-to-back, right? So they play Monday, Tuesday, then they play Thursday, Saturday. So probably just a good streamer for your first 2 days, and then you might want to move off them. But for Florida, there is going to be some people with some opportunity here, especially if Barkov is out with injury. And we're looking at Sam Bennett-Dyson. He's out there. And we're looking at Anton Lundell. These are guys that are going to get the deployment in Barkov's stead, right? Lundell could get that top line even strength deployment, and Bennett could get the power play deployment. So of those two players, how are you prioritizing them?
Yeah, I think you got to go Bennett first. He just does everything we need for fantasy. He hits, he shoots, he does it all. He's had a hot start here in terms of the underlying metrics. So I think you got to go Bennett first, but I am legitimately excited if Lundell does get that top line role, which I haven't seen anything to indicate it, but I'm already like 95% sure that it's going to happen.
Yeah. I mean, they've done it before, right? With Barkov out, we've seen Lundell go up there under Paul Maurice. And again, this is a player that is just taking another step in his development. It's a guy that we should be excited about. He's great defensively. They've been working on that part of his game and putting him in those positions, but he's never really been put in offensive positions. But we saw like a nice performance from Lundell in the playoffs last year. He came to play. I think there's some real value there. I don't like the center only, but you know, whatever. So that's interesting. You got Erod there as well. I mean, as a kind of a lesser streamer. And then Adam Boqvist, we just got to check his status, right? Because if he's out there, he's going to get power play one, and power play one in Florida, that's very valuable. So this is a guy that you should definitely own for that back-to-back and see what he does. Like I would hold him probably even for through the busy games, just if he's still getting that deployment, I think I would hold him just to see what's going on, because I'm intrigued, right? Like, you know, we saw Brandon Montour pop off for 70 points on the Florida power play. I'm not saying that Boqvist can do that, but are you saying that, Nate?
I haven't said that, but okay. I've noted that this is a spot where nobody expected Brandon Montour to have the season he did. And this is the exact team, the exact situation that kind of begat all of that. So I think it's possible that Boqvist has a much better season than anyone's expecting.
Yeah, absolutely, man. So I'm interested there, which is so weird. Why I'm interested in Adam Boqvist, for God's sake. And then New Jersey is the other team there. You know, we're looking at Dawson Mercer, Eric Halla, Stefan Nason, Paul Cotter. What is this man doing? What the hell got into him? He actually looked good in those games in Prague. Like, he looked really good to me. Not just fluking into some points, like really hardworking goals and some nice set of mitts on him as well. So I'm interested there. Andre Palat as well. What I see the name Casey here. What is that guy's first name? Sean?
Seamus.
Oh, God. That's terrible. All right. He did zip a pretty nice wrister, though, for his first goal there in Prague. Really nice looking player. I mean, they were prioritizing him over Nemec a little bit, which was an interesting move. I'm curious to see how that moves forward. And then Brendan Dillon for Beaver Leagues, if you're interested there. I mean, anything to say about those players there in New Jersey, Nate?
No, definitely. I think they're both well below the Bennett Lundell tier of streamers for me.
Yeah, absolutely. But that's it. That's it for crossing the streams. We crossed the streams. We aimed it straight, and then we crossed it again. That's what we just did there, and that feels really good. But now, Nate, you got to talk to us a little bit about some other stuff here.
Yeah, just want to mention briefly the Apples and Geos Patreon again. Supporter tier, $2 a month gets you access to patron-only live shows. I am going to be doing a live show on the upcoming Monday. What day is that? That would be the 14th tier upcoming. So you'll have access to it after the fact if you aren't able to join the live show, but definitely it'll be better if you join live. You can ask questions live. I'm going to be talking about how I'm approaching goalie situations, what kind of heuristic I use to use 0G in season, because obviously if you went 0G, your goalies are going to be a little up in the air at any given point in the season, and that's the way I think you should like it. Personally, so definitely going to be an episode that you're going to want to check out. So $2 a month gets you in the door there. $8 a month gets you the patron only live shows, also gets you patron only Discord channels in the Discord server, gets you access to show notes like the ones that we put together for this show right here, and also gets you the Apples and Geos player evaluation tool, where you can compare players directly on all the stats that matter most for fantasy and figure out which player you should be adding, dropping, trading, whatever it is you need to do. For the degenerates out there, the Geno's tier, $15 a month. Get all the perks that we mentioned so far, but also all questions personally answered by yours truly. Let's move over. Blake, what is this next segment called?
I appreciate that, Nate. Thanks for kicking to me there. This next segment is the best players to stream for this week, or as Nate loves to call it, the dream streams.
All right, let's get into it. Best for points, I will rank these 1 through 10 with an honorable mention thrown in for good measure. At the top of the list, I think you got to go with Casey Mittelstadt just for sheer point scoring. He's already getting big minutes as the second line center in Colorado. He's going to be on the top power play. He was there even when Drouin was still there. So I think that role is pretty locked in now with Drouin out. So I really like Casey Mittelstadt for this week as the top guy with all those off nights. It doesn't get better than that. Rickard Rakell, the next guy up here. Definitely think that this is contingent on maintaining that top power play. You know, if you told me Bunting was on the top power play, I'd swap the two immediately. So this is really contingent on top power play. So definitely check what happens when and if Russ comes back. And maybe you don't want to be that risky if you don't have a good sense by the time you have to make this ad. But if Rakell maintains the top power play, I think he is worth this spot. Moving down, this is based on the off nights. I should have mentioned that at the front, but you know, I'm a little bit out of practice. It's a new season, but I am basing this on off nights. I have to go with the players that I know can get into your lineup. So even with only two off nights for San Jose, I did put Tyler Toffoli up here. He is 50% rostered, like I mentioned, so it's a pretty good chance that he's not out there in more competitive leagues, but he absolutely has to be on this list because he has to be rostered. I think there's a pretty strong chance that he pots 30 on this team, the newly exciting San Jose Sharks. Yeah. Moving on down, I had Genther in this list, but then he quickly rose above 50% rostered today. Actually, he went from like, I forget, he started at like 45, now he's up to like 53. So he's shooting up very quickly here, and rightfully so. But I'll move on down to Nick Schmaltz here. Nick Schmaltz, Barrett Hayton, kind of side by side for me, obviously getting the exact same deployment. Hayton's scored the goals, but Schmaltz has taken the shots kind of so far. So I would take Schmaltz over Hayton for sure, personally. Jake Wallman, I wanted to have in here alongside Brant Clark. I do think both of these guys are going to be on the top power play for the foreseeable future. Wallman also is going to have a huge even strength role, it's starting to look like, there in San Jose. So that's pretty exciting. And I think that this is a player, we'll talk about him later as well, but a player that you can add and you might just hang on to for the entire season here. Ross Colton, Michael Bunting, Nikolai Kovalenko, these are kind of the other players with the four off nights that we're a little bit less excited about in terms of the point scoring upside, but just with all the off nights, they're going to brute force their way into getting you some fantasy points. So that's the list, Blake. Tear it apart. Tell me what I got wrong.
You know I can't, buddy. We talked about it offline. This list is mint. All right, you got to get these players on your roster.
For sure. Let's move over to just some quick talk about Bangers League. So best for hits, you got Tanner Janot, you got Josh Manson, you got Mario Ferraro. Kyle Burrows in LA is a good look as well. Nico Mikola from Florida, I think, is a solid look there. On the block side, you got Ferraro back here. Jake Wallman really shows out in blocks. So if blocks are worth a lot in your league, Wallman shows out doubly in that kind of format. Ryan Graves, Marcus Pedersen from Pittsburgh there. You can get them in with the off nights, and they're going to definitely provide some blocks for you. And Mikola shows up on the block side as well. Any of these names of interest to you for the hits here, Blake, or are there any that I may have missed that you want to add?
No, nothing that I see here. These all make sense. And yeah, I feel good about this.
All right. Then we can continue on to Hold Me. This is a segment that we did do last year, but we've given it a new name because we do want to hold these players potentially for the rest of the season. We're looking at long-term plays here, players that we think we can hang on to for the rest of the season. Obviously, Dylan Genther, absolute priority. Shallow leagues, wherever you are, you got to go add Dylan Genther if he still is somehow out there. So definitely just go check and make sure in your leagues. But moving on beyond the obvious, JJ Paterka is still only 40% rostered. I think that should definitely change in short order here. Gabriel Vilardi, as I mentioned, I am pretty high on this guy. I think he has 30-plus goal potential this year. He's at 43% rostered. Pavel Zacha, 26% rostered. Line one, power play one in Boston there alongside Pastrnak. Basically, every time Zacha's on the ice, Pastrnak is also there. Like that's how you want to get your minutes in. So Zacha is a priority for me as well. Toffoli makes this list, as we mentioned. Dylan Strome is on this list, down to 35% rostered, but I think he's locked in as Alex Ovechkin's center, and he's gonna get probably 19 minutes a night, I think, is maybe a reasonable projection for Dylan Strome at this point. It'll be interesting to see. Washington actually hasn't played yet. They're, I think, the only team that hasn't played yet.
They play on Saturday.
Yeah, so it'll be interesting to see what they do there. Obviously, PLD coming in there, they've got some different centers that they might use a little bit differently. But I do think that Dylan Strome is probably going to be Ovechkin's guy and thereby get the most of the minutes. Nick Schmaltz, Barrett Hayton, we've already talked about, but I do think both these guys have long-term potential on your roster as line one, power play one players in Utah alongside the luminescent talents of Clayton Keller and Dylan Guenther. Sam Bennett here, definitely you have to add Sam Bennett. With Barkov out, you have to imagine his minutes go up, even if the line that he's playing on doesn't change. Jonathan Drouin, obviously injured at the moment, but at 29% rostered, seems like he's going to be on the power play and at least until Nichushkin comes back, and possibly even beyond that, until Landeskog maybe comes back. So I think that Drouin definitely should be rostered more than 29%. Moving on to sub 20% rostered players, I've got a long list. It's always this way at the beginning of the season. Yeah. It starts to even out once people realize, hey, these guys are actually scoring some points. But I've got Leo Carlson, Troy Terry, Casey Mittelstadt, Barrett Hayton shows up. He's actually at 11% rostered, so he shows up in this segment as well. Anthony Duclair, Josh Norris, Shane Pinto, and Victor Olofsson are all below 20% rostered at the moment and are definitely worth checking out. I don't know, Blake, anybody from the list sub 20% that's really a highlight for you, somebody that you're targeting?
Yeah, I mean, Leo Carlson is obviously one that I'm super high on. And just with the off nights that Anaheim has this year, I really do think it's 20 minutes and power play one for Leo Carlson this year. So it's just, again, the Greg Cronin experience. We don't like that. But also Anthony Duclair, nice little game there with the New York Islanders. Line one, power play one. Well, let's see what we got here.
For sure. Sub 10% rostered, you've got guys like Kirill Marchenko, Maxim Tsiplikov, Laferriere, who we've talked about, Igor Chinnikov with those 21 minutes, Connor Zeri playing on the top power play in Calgary. That's a good look at 5% rostered. Fabian Zetterlund, who we've talked about, Kirby Dach on the top power play in Montreal, and then Marco Rossi with some Kaprizov exposure. Talk to us about your guy Tsiplikov, Blake. Obviously, this was your hot take.
Yeah, I mean, I was surprised by the 20 minutes that he got. That is a surprise, right? But 6 hits. So that's one area where I wasn't sure kind of what to expect. Like, you know, is like I couldn't find the statistics there in the KHL. But this guy that they're kind of high on him, and he's getting 20 minutes right off the hop in an important game where they lost by one goal. Like that's a good sign. So I think this is a player of interest for sure. A speculative ad as well, if you want to get ahead of the game, right? Because this could be a guy like, you know, my hot take was 65 points. I mean, that's pretty damn hot, but I don't know if Tsiplikov gets 50 points, that's an absolute smash. That's a success, especially if he's got good banger numbers. So I like that. Buddy, what about Connor Zari's overtime goal the other night? You see that thing? Gee.
Yeah. Yeah, Zari's been a player of interest there. It seems like they've been kind of slow playing him a little bit, but this could be the year that, the Flames could use some scoring for sure, and they're not going to be shy about using him if he shows that he can hang this year. So I do think that Zari's a good look. Long-term plays on the defensive side of things, Justin Falk is still somehow only 50% rostered. The guy's got 3 points in the first 3 games of the season here on the top power play, skating 23 minutes a night. What is not to love about Justin Falk? Jake Walman shows up here again as my number 2, 11% rostered. I've got Owen Power up here at number 3, 35% rostered. He's been on that top power play after Lindy Ruff moved the power play units around. I don't really know how long he sticks on that unit as a second defenseman. Kind of feels like that never really does stick, but Owen Power, like he's a great player. Like, he's a legitimately a great player. And if Buffalo can really turn things around and get things kind of kickstarted here, maybe he doesn't even need the top power play to really be a long-term hold for you. That's definitely within the range of outcomes for the former number one overall pick. Adam Boqvist and Brant Clark, both similar archetypes, I would say, at this point, running top power plays and playing kind of third pair minutes. But I do think that both have potential to really pop off this year, and you have to be interested in acquiring either or both of these players. And then Bowen Byram, I've thrown in here at the end, 41% rostered. Been playing a lot of minutes there in Buffalo in the early going. It really does seem like they're going with a kind of top three of Dahlin, Power, and Byram. And that's obviously good things for Byram, who's just one of the most efficient defensemen in terms of goal scoring. Also bangs a lot, so he's good for your bangers league. So I like Bowen Byram there as well. Sub 20% rostered, you got Wallman and Boqvist both at 11%, so you've definitely got options there. Sub 10% rostered, you can get down to Erik Gustafsson, you can get Jamie Drysdale there, you can get Owen Zellweger there. If you need those off nights at defense next week, maybe you pick up the Zellweger, maybe you pick up the Minchikov. You can get that on your roster and just see where it goes next week. I do think that there'll be more changes to those units. It would be shocking if Zellweger is held off a power play unit all year long. Any players from the defensemen here, Blake, anybody I may have missed?
Sean Durzi to me is one for sure. Like, just with the deployment that he's getting, I think that's going to be a valuable player. And then Lane Hutson is another one. Like, I know we've talked about this player a little bit, but I like the deployment, like 20 minutes plus. That's pretty damn nice. And he's tilting the ice a little bit out there. Expected goals are pretty high when Hudson's out on the ice. So yeah, even if he doesn't get power play one, I mean, we could still be looking at a 40 point player here with, you know, ceiling for more. He's a really skilled offensive player. So yeah, I like Lane Hutson a lot this year as well.
All right, let's continue on to the goaltenders. Yeah, it's obviously that weird part of the season where we're still trying to figure out some tandems. We've got some teams apparently going with three goaltenders, which is always a huge headache for fantasy purposes. But as we see it right now, we've got Charlie Lindgren there at 41% rostered. Logan Thompson has been a little dinged up here, and so Lindgren could get some run. And, you know, we've seen it before. Yeah. We've seen the proof of concept. Lindgren can get hot for an extended stretch of time. Sam Montembeault at 49%, obviously big reaction to his massive, I forget how many saves it was.
47 or something like that. Yeah,
something like that. Shutting out the Leafs there on opening night. I don't know if I really trust Montembeault to like hold down a true number one starting role, or I trust, you know, Montreal to not let him get absolutely shelled every night and the cracks start to eventually show there. But you can't ignore a performance like that, that's for sure. Archer Shelovs I have here at 36%. I think that they're going to go back to him next week. Vancouver has three games next week. My best guess at this point is that despite the game that was, it was not super enjoyable to watch for Artur Shelov's rosterers, but I do think that he probably gets the next start again. I know that Lankinen, only allowed two goals in the game here on Friday night. Lost in a shootout, but it's a good effort from Lankinen, but I think there is some organizational trust there with Shelovs. Obviously played for them in the playoffs last year. Yep. I think Shelovs probably gets the first start next week, and I do think that the Vancouver net is so valuable, you have to just kind of be in on whoever might get starts there. So that's a spot that I'm watching very closely, and I think Shelovs has a better start in him the next time around. Sub 25% rostered. I will throw Lankinen in there at 25% rostered. Very closely watching what happens. If Lankinen does get the next start for Vancouver, then absolutely you should be all in on Lankinen at that point, and you should be picking him up. Petr Mrazek, 11% rostered. Samuel Ersson, 19% rostered. Lukas Dostal, 9% rostered here. All options for your deeper 0G leagues. Any goalies there you want to highlight?
Oh God. I agree with your take on Shelovs. I think that's just watch that closely. I do think Shelovs has earned the next start and could get two of the three games next week.
For sure. All right, Blake, we need to move on. We need to tackle the head-to-head streamer deathmatch.
Oh yeah, buddy. This feels good already. Let's talk to me, Nate. Talk to me about what's going on here.
Yeah, well, what's going on here is Dylan Cousins was your pick from last week. My pick was Jack Quinn. Cousins has 9 kickoffle points after 3 games played with 1 to go, and Quinn has 1.25 points after 3 games played. He literally has done the only thing more than nothing that's possible.
He's just going for a skate. He's having a nice time. He's out in Prague like he was, you know, he's catching the sights. I mean, I don't know. That's a nice time.
Yeah, absolutely brutal. Now the power play is moving all around. Dylan Cousins, I will say, really looking good under the hood. That's a player that I'm actually trying to acquire in my leagues because I do think there's a chance that we see a pop off here for Cousins and he goes back to being that guy that we were super excited about 2 seasons ago. I'm really into Dylan Cousins based off what we're seeing. I know that the score sheet hasn't exactly lit up for him yet, but I think that's coming. All right, Blake, we need to make some picks here for the next week. So for this, we're not really considering off nights. We're just considering games played. But we need to have some picks. We need to get that head-to-head deathmatch on the roll for week 2. Blake, it is your turn to pick first. Who do you have?
All right. Well, and even before we do this, Nate, we forgot to mention that we've upped the stakes. All right. Nate and I used to go 50% and under for roster. Now, for this season here, 25% rostered and under. We're really getting the biz here. So yeah, we gotta, you know, test our mettle. And I'm gonna pick about the most mid player that exists in the NHL. His name's Casey Mittelstadt. He's got a beautiful head of hair, as we know. I mean, beautiful long locks. And he also puts the biscuit in the basket on the regular. He's an amazing facilitator, and I'm going with Casey Mittelstadt, and it feels good.
Yeah. That's definitely a player that I was considering if you hadn't picked him, but I think it was probably the most obvious pick there. Top power play in Colorado, like pretty hard to disagree with. I'm going to go with my guy, Mikael Granlund here, who I think was the next best. I think that Granlund is pretty underrated. He's going to play on the top power play. He's going to skate 18 plus minutes a night. I don't know how many of the other guys that we were looking at. There's not that many teams that play 4 games next week. So I don't know how many of the other players you can reasonably say that about that are still out there. I could take a swing on the finding the correct Pittsburgh guy, you know, but knowing what we know now, I don't feel confident in going with a guy like Ricard Raquel just because he might be completely bumped off the top power play, could be even moved down the lineup, who knows. So the route that I have decided to go here is with Mikael Granlund.
This is what you call a clash of the titans. Oh my god, has anyone seen a battle this epic before, Nate? I don't know.
Yeah, I think this is what the people come to us for, Blake. They come see us pick Casey Mittelstadt versus Mikael Granlund, and they will wait all next week with bated breath to find out who outscores the other.
That's good content. So, yeah, that's confirmed.
Confirmed. All right. Well, if you made it this far, you should absolutely check out the description and join the Discord community. While you're here, like, rate, review, subscribe, comment, all of that really does help us out. It's the best way that you can show support for our work here if it is bringing you any value. But I think that's going to be all that we've got for this episode. Hopefully it brought you some value, helped you get a little bit better at fantasy hockey today. All the advanced stats you heard today came from Natural Stat Trick, which is a terrific free resource. Many thanks to the band there for supplying the music for the podcast. Be sure to check out their Spotify as well. That's it, folks. Much love.